The decision version of Knapsack is NP-complete, and the optimization version of Knapsack is an NP-hard problem. And what we now want to do is we want to develop a fully polynomial time approximation scheme for the optimization problem Knapsack. The technique we use for that is a standard technique to derive fully polynomial time approximation schemes. It doesn't mean that all FP tasks are designed this way, but it's a common thing that for quite a few problems can work. You might have to modify it a little bit depending on the circumstances, but the general idea often remains the same. It all starts with having a dynamic program for your problem. And I think you should know already a dynamic program for the Knapsack problem, but just in case you don't remember, so here's an example of a dynamic program for Knapsack. When you design a dynamic program, you need to identify suitable subproblems of the original problem. One way of doing this for the Knapsack problem is to formulate subproblems as follows. We look at the optimal solutions that only involve considering the first I of the items and with a weight limit of lowercase w. And so we are just asking if we only can use the first I items to potentially include in the Knapsack, and our weight limit is changed to lowercase w, what is the optimal value we can get from this? What is the possible maximum value we can achieve for this particular subproblem? We then need to establish a relationship between those subproblems. So for this, assume we already know all the solutions to the subproblems involving the first I minus 1 items. Then what are the solutions look like if we consider the first I items? So the only difference really is that now we can consider including the ith item in our subset. There are two basic cases. The first case is that we get a solution that does not involve item I, in which case we are just left with the first I minus 1 items, and we should just select the best subset out of those that observe the weight limit, of course. The second case is that we do pack item I in our Knapsack. In that case, our weight limit changes because item I has a certain weight. So if the weight limit before was lowercase w, then the new weight limit is the same, but we have to subtract the weight of item I from that. So that's the new weight limit. And then with this new weight limit, we just need to find the best possible solution for the first I minus 1 item. So we already committed to packing the ith item. Now, with a reduced weight limit, we're just looking for the best possible solution for the first I minus 1 items. And if we already know those solutions, we can simply look that up and combine the two. And this gives us a simple recursion formulation for these subproblems. And we also know that in the beginning, like when I is equal to 0, so we are not allowed to pack any items, of course the maximum value we can get is 0. So those solutions, the value of those solutions is obvious. And otherwise we can just use the previously described recursion. There's one special case where we have to be a bit careful. So if item I itself already weighs more than what the weight limit of the Knapsack is, so if wi is already bigger than lowercase w, then of course we cannot pack item I. So we are already in this first case. We know that for sure. So that's kind of a technical special case. One way of thinking about this dynamic program is to picture a big table, and the entries in this table will be the solution to these subproblems. The rows of the table will be the different possible weight limits, and the columns of the table will be depending on how many of the items I'm allowed to use in my solution. So the first column, say, is corresponds to the empty set where I'm not allowed to use any of the items. And then the second column corresponds to the set only containing the first item, so that's the only item I'm allowed to use. The third column would correspond to the first and the second item that I'm allowed to use, and so on. And the goal is to just fill out the values in this table with the values of those subproblems. And we do this from left to right. And so we fill in the first column first because that's trivial. We know that all the values have to be zero. And then we move from left to right. And each entry in the table is a simple combination of some of the previous entries in the previous columns that we already filled in. So if we assume that looking up a value in the table takes constant time, and then doing operations like simple arithmetic operations on those numbers, like comparing them or adding them up or subtracting them, also takes constant time, then filling in each entry in the table will only require constant time. So the running time of the algorithm is mainly dependent on the size of the table. And we know what the size of the table is. The number of columns in the table is in the order of n, the number of items. And the number of rows in the table, well, that's a number of different rate limits we look at. But really, what is the largest possible rate limit that makes sense to consider? Well, we start with this capital W as an input to our problem instance. And that's the maximum number of rows we should be required to fill in for this table. So the running time of this algorithm is really in the order of n times capital W. This may seem like an efficient, meaning polynomial time algorithm, but it's not, because this capital W is a number that is presented in the input. And we said, unless otherwise specified, numbers encoded in an input are always encoded in binary. So the value of capital W is exponential in the size of the encoding of that value. And therefore, if W is large, capital W is large, this is not necessarily a polynomial time algorithm. But the important thing to notice here is that the only reason why it's not a polynomial time algorithm is because the weights of the items can be large compared to the number of items in the input, for example. If the weights are all of polynomial size in n, then everything is fine. Our algorithm would already be a polynomial time algorithm. And this observation is sort of the key to get to this fully polynomial time approximation scheme that we want to develop.